This book is in the style of what I would call a philosophical polemic. It's not a treatise in the sense of, you know, reasoning from start to finish in a linear fashion. It's written to ostensibly to a man named Charles-François de Pont, who really wanted to know Burke's opinion about the French Revolution in its early stage. And at first, Burke was just going to write a letter, and I think he did. Then he thought better of the brief answer that he'd given, and then after a while he thought about the fact that maybe he wanted other people to know about his opinion, and it turned into this book, which was later published as a book, and then, you know, called Reflections on the Revolution in France, that he wanted a lot of people to read. But it's interesting that it started out as kind of a letter. It's not systematically organized. It's sometimes repetitious. As a matter of fact, I mostly don't ask my students to read the entire work. I ask them to read about the first two-thirds. It's sometimes emotive. In fact, it's often emotive, just like Burke was in the House of Commons. You know, he was an emotional man, and so that comes out in many ways, and sometimes brilliant turns of phrase. It's a work of rhetoric, and that rhetoric, which means just, you know, emotive kind of proclamations and you know, the style that would draw out people's anger and their indignation, but isn't necessarily well reasoned, along with parts that are extremely well reasoned. As a political philosophy professor, I tend to focus in on those parts that are well-reasoned, but I think that it's important to acknowledge that they were embedded on purpose into a great deal of kind of emotive rhetoric, which Burke no doubt thought, rightly, is a better form of communication as far as persuading most people. So I think that it turns out very well done. Now, in the background, there's events that Burke very much has in mind from the 17th century at first here with the English Civil War, the Revolution of 1642, in which the English Parliament, taken over by dissenting Christians, Presbyterians, Puritans, and the like, and they were worried that Charles' progeny would impose Catholicism on them. And they actually ended up executing Charles I and bringing in Oliver Cromwell and changing the government. Oliver Cromwell was a Puritan who turned out to be rather dictatorial. Anybody who wants to know about that could do no better than to read Thomas Hobbes' Behemoth, which is a history of that revolution and the English Civil War. Of course, Hobbes didn't like any of that. It was a nasty time, and the English went through several changes in government over this short period of time between 1642 and 1651, and then they ended up being exhausted, sort of jaded with this radical experiment in more or less democratic government that turned into the sort of theocratic government. And they reverted to the monarchy and asked Charles II, the heir of Charles I, to come back into power, which, by the way, if I were Charles II, I would have hightailed it right out of there. But he did his duty and came back. Now, when Charles II died, his brother took over. And James was a Catholic, and I think that the English were willing to sort of tolerate that for a period of time. But when he had a son, all bets were off, and there was another revolution, the Revolution of 1688, that brought in William and Mary. Mary was James's Protestant daughter. And they made, the English made William and Mary co-sovereigns, basically. So there was this in the background. Now, just so that you know, like, Burke was nauseated by the first revolution and that whole Civil War history. Burke though, accepted and admired what happened during the so-called Glorious Revolution of 1688, which was not as bloody. In fact, very little blood was shed in the process of deposing the king and bringing in these new monarchs. Now, the premier event, the event that is, you know, really the instigator for this book, is the French Revolution that began in 1789. And as we'll see, you know, a lot of people in England looked on to France and thought, well, they're having their own maybe glorious revolution. They're changing, but it's good. You know, it's bringing in certain changes in a popular direction that perhaps people need. But as we now know, and as Burke could see very early on, the French Revolution was way more radical. All revolutions are radical, okay? And I would contend even the Glorious Revolution was radical in its own way. But the French Revolution was crazy radical, okay? And in its early stages, I think it was not so easy to see, especially from the distance of England. But Burke could see the kernel of radicalism within it that led to Robespierre. They used to take their enemies, or the people they deemed to be enemies, the French revolutionaries did, and put them on barges and basically set them aflame and let them sink into the river. Well, there's more to be said about the radicalism of the French Revolution, but Burke could see it. All right, so those are the three big events, the events from the past, as well as the ongoing event that Burke is writing about during this time in this work. And there's this group of people in England, group of men, the Revolution Society, that more or less depicted itself as pro-Glorious Revolution, identifying with the Glorious Revolution. And, you know, at this point in time, was making the connection between the Glorious Revolution and the French Revolution, and vice versa, trying to talk about how the French Revolution was very much like what their country had done, and that it ought to be supported. And so not only were members of the Revolution Society talking about the French Revolution favorably in England, but they were also speaking on behalf of England to the French. They had more or less sent emissaries to France to say, yes, the Revolution Society of England supports you, okay? They interpreted the Glorious Revolution in a way that Burke more or less disagreed with, because they saw in the Glorious Revolution the principle that the people of England had chosen their monarchy in a sort of democratic election, and that had more or less cemented the idea of the democratic basis for the rule of the monarchs. Burke disagrees entirely. And he's worried because it looks like the Revolution Society is trying to spread the radicalism of the French Revolution to England. So the first thing that Burke does is he schools Dupont, the young man to whom he is writing. And he says, first of all, I'm not at all associated with the Revolution Society, and these people have been talking to you over there and may have misled you. But if you respect me, basically, I have to tell you, you shouldn't be listening to them, okay? He says to Dupont, they're doing something improper by opening, quote, a formal public correspondence with the actual government of a foreign nation without the express authority of the government of England. So there he's accusing the Revolution Society of overstepping its bounds and speaking for the nation of England, which they are just a private group and they shouldn't have done. And then he more seriously says, they're also very wrong, okay? He says, am I seriously to felicitate a madman? Now here he's talking about, you know, the the French revolutionaries. So he's already seeing the, you know, these revolutionaries as more or less having gone mad. You know, they're kind of crazy over there. Am I to seriously congratulate a madman who has escaped from the protecting restraint and wholesome darkness of his cell on his restoration to the enjoyment of his light and liberty? Maybe not. But the Revolution Society does, okay? They're basically doing that. They're celebrating and congratulating people who have gone mad over here in this other country and giving what they are doing too much respect by more or less associating it with the English Glorious Revolution. He also says, I flatter myself that I love a manly, moral, regulated liberty. Now, that term manly in this context can be kind of misconstrued because it comes through modern ears, but it was said all the time back then, of course, and what it just meant was just firm, serious, mature, controlled, not crazy, not, you know, flippant, but rather, you know, prudent and mature, okay? And so he's gonna, in this book, distinguish between a type of liberty that is basically license, you know, the freedom to do anything you want whenever you want, including all sorts of harm, and the type of liberty that is constrained and controlled by social, cultural, political, religious institutions and mechanisms. We are not free to do anything. We are only free to do what a human being ought to do within this particular context and within the bounds of duty and responsibility, from his view of liberty. Okay, so he schools Dupont. And then he rebukes this Reverend Richard Price. Now, Reverend Price was a member, a prominent member, of the Revolution Society. And so Reverend Price, using the pulpit, Burke says, gives an address to the Revolution Society that is also printed up, and Burke gets a copy, and he sees it as a representative of, you know, the Revolution Society's admirations for the French Revolution and their designs on England for making it more revolutionary. And here's where he makes the point about religion and politics. He compares Price's rhetoric to the radical Christian dissenting rhetoric of the 1642 revolution, when a lot of dissenting Christians and radical Presbyterians had basically plunged the country into civil war and had tried to enact all sorts of really, you know, big changes in the form of government that would lead to a kind of theocratic popular government of sorts. They used the pulpit all the time to politic, right? And of course, in his view, it was a complete disaster. I think pretty much everybody agreed with that at this point in time, as Burke was writing. And so he's saying, look, you know, Reverend Price, you sound an awful lot like those crazy radicals back then that plunged our country into bloodshed and warfare, killed a king, and, you know, took us decades and decades to recover from. He calls what Price did a, quote, political sermon, and he says, no sound ought to be heard in the church but the healing voice of Christian charity. So that's a theme that comes back again and again. It's not so much that he's not asking for a separation of church and state in the sense of, you know, getting rid of the establishment of the Church of England. Rather, he's talking about there's two different spheres here. You know, there's the sphere that the church resides in, which should have to do with people's souls and with the establishment of charity and community. And then there's, you know, the political regime over here, and it has to do with law and order and, you know, making sure that people don't kill each other and so on. And those are two separate jobs, okay? And they shouldn't mix those jobs. All right. Here's a great quote that illustrates his disdain for the way that Price thought. He says, as to the kings of this world, all of whom except one, this arch pontiff of the rights of men, that's Richard Price, with all the plenitude and with more than the boldness of the papal deposing of power in its meridian fervor of the 12th century, puts into one sweeping clause of ban and anathema and proclaims usurpers by circles of longitude and latitude over the whole globe, it behooves them to consider consider how they admit into their territories these apostolic missionaries who are to tell their subjects they are not lawful kings. Okay, so, you know, the Revolution Society had said that the English king, the English monarch, was legitimate because that monarchy came from what they considered to be the legitimate event of 1688. But no others were, because they weren't selected by the people. And you see Burke here saying, well, you know, this man is talking like a Catholic pope, basically. Now, in the context of the time, that was definitely a bad thing, okay? In and of itself, this sort of sounds a little anti-Catholic here, right? But the point is, you know, the pope makes these decrees and bans and you know, proclaims something anathema. And here we have Richard Price basically taking into himself this authority to basically say who's a legitimate king and who isn't. And it would really behoove any monarch, any sort of government, okay, to be careful about bringing somebody like Richard Price and the Revolution Society and their tracts into their space, because this is not the type of thinking that you want. It's destabilizing thinking. Burke thinks it's wrong and dangerous, okay? Now, then he turns to how should we see the glorious revolution? And here's where Burke, well, I'll talk more about this in another video, I'm sure, but here's where Burke, I think, gets into a little bit of trouble, okay? Now, the way that he wants us to see the glorious revolution is that it didn't deviate from the tradition and the English Constitution, which is not one document, but it's a series of documents and events and an understanding of how the government should work. But, you know, he would say that the Glorious Revolution upheld the English Constitution, including its hereditary right of succession, that it didn't change everything dramatically, but rather it returned practice back to the spirit of the original Constitution, or more closely to the tradition, through the actions of changing from one monarch to another, right? So we get the succession because Mary is the daughter of James, right? And it rebalances the power between the monarch and the parliament, which I guess you, according to this way of arguing, you would have to say had become unbalanced, right? And he also says it was an necessary and extraordinary act that does not set a precedent, that just because something like this had to happen at this point in time to correct certain grave errors did not mean that this is the way change should happen from now on. So he makes all of these arguments. I would just say for now that, and we'll talk about this more in other videos, but the Glorious Revolution was a little bit more radical than Burke wants to make it out to be. It did change the relationship between the monarch and the parliament quite dramatically, and in fact, though it didn't quite work this way for a while, it established legislative supremacy. You know, it gave a lot of more power to the parliament. Now, Burke says the two houses in the act of King William, that is bringing William and Mary in, did not thank God that they had found a fair opportunity to assert a right to choose their own governors. They threw a politic well-wrought veil over every circumstance tending to weaken the rights which in the meliorated order of succession they meant to perpetuate, or which might furnish a precedent for any future departure from what they had then settled forever. Now, that may be true in the sense that, yes, they did cast a veil over the change. And yes, they did not get rid of the idea of you know, hereditary succession of monarchy. But they did do this. You know, that's a section from the Declaration of Right. Freedom of speech and debates or proceedings in Parliament ought not to be impeached or questioned in any court or place out of Parliament. And there's plenty more like this, okay? It rebalanced the power quite a bit in Parliament's favor. So this is important to keep in mind. Does Burke not know this? Yes, of course he knows this. And I think that part of his strategy is that even if he does know this, what's important is the stability of England, the stability of the political culture. And, you know, any sort of talk that emphasizes dramatic change or a departure from tradition or practice inserts in people's minds the idea that more departures are legitimate, and there's a price to pay for that, in his view, a price to pay for getting used to the idea that you can just change anything whenever you want to. So when we come back next time, I'll talk a little bit more about 1688, and that'll keep coming up, and we'll try to get into like why it is that Burke thinks that sometimes it's good to throw a politic, well-wrought veil over the truth, and whether that's ever really a good idea or not.